Good morning. Good morning. Isn't there a song like that? Good morning, good morning, good morning. Seems like there's a song like that I've heard. It's good to see all of you in God's house. We're thankful that you're here this morning. For those of you worshiping with us online, we're thankful for you as well. And we hope that you'll drop us a note on Facebook and let us know that you're here with us. In your case, there's a little thing in the bulletin called the communication card. And you can tear that off and give us your information. And there's a box in the foyer for us to receive that information. We want to know that you are here. We pray over these each week. So please be sure that you fill that out for us today. Headlines this week in the news was about the CDC, right? I think it caught everyone by surprise. No one seemed to know what to do with that. And so we're no different. What I want to say to you is that we will make adjustments as soon as we possibly can. Our safety and security team lead told me Tuesday night, told the council, I respect the CDC, but I listen to Dr. Madrigal. And so we're going to talk to Dr. Madrigal this week and see what adjustments we can make. But thank you for your patience. We will work on that as soon as we possibly can. I wanted to remind you, for those who don't know, we're slowly restarting things. We've got Bibles and hymnals in the rack now. We have the name tags uncovered. We have restarted valet parking. So if you need help getting your car parked and located, you can take care of that. Just drive up in the portico and someone will park your car for you. What a deal. You don't even have to tip them. I mean, unless you want to, but no, you don't even have to tip them. So wanted to remind you also about the prayer service, which will be tomorrow evening in the sanctuary here at 6 o'clock. And that is a really special, very small, intimate service. And people can come. We usually have a chair right about here. And folks can come if they would like special prayer about an illness or a need in their family. And we can pray over them as we can with these things. Honoring social distancing, folks sit in the pews and raise their hands and pray in that direction. So just know that that's a wonderful opportunity if you have a prayer need or if you have a celebration. Maybe you've just received really good news at MD Anderson, like somebody I know. They might want to come and just praise that they got really good news at MD Anderson. That's huge. So anyway, please plan to come tomorrow evening at 6 o'clock for a very special, again, very quiet, intimate service. I think that's all the announcements I have, but I'm hurrying so I can shut up because we have the Hambricks today. And I'm so excited. So let us begin our time of worship with this special music.
I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and His glory, of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story because I know it's true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. Tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and His love.
I love to tell the story, 'tis pleasant to repeat, what seems each time I tell it, more wonderfully sweet. I love
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. And I neglected to mention, it's in the bulletin, but we have a new baby in the congregation. And so for Riley Grace Fuller, we're thankful, and we have a rosebud on the altar for her today. She was born last Sunday morning on Mother's Day. Isn't that awesome? Brothers and sisters, please stand as you're able for our call to worship and prayer. I guess it's a prayer today. Let us pray it together. God of incredible surprises, as we gaze into the clouds, remind us that we are standing on holy ground. Place our feet on the pathways of peace and hope. Draw our attention from the vision of the Lord rising to the heavens to be with you, and help us to focus on the ministries that you would have us do. Keep us ready and willing always to serve you all our days. Amen.
Open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Place in my hands the wonderful key that shall unclasp and set me free. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my
I would like to invite the adults to be seated and children and Stephanie to come forward. Why don't we get here? Stephanie, why don't you sit closer to the kids and put the microphone so if they talk, those on the live stream could hear us.
Hello, friends. Hi. Good morning. Hello.
Woo-hoo. Hi, guys.
All right.
I brought my box.
Now come over. I'll scoop down.
I got my box over here, and I have some stuff in this box that I don't know exactly what to do with. I got tools. Does anyone here like tools?
Love tools.
You love it?
Everyone loves it.
That is awesome, because I'm a little embarrassed. I don't know what they all do.
You don't?
But maybe you guys could help me out. I think I know how to use them. Like, I got this thing here, and it looks like it's a sword, right? No? It's a flathead. What does it do?
It's supposed to twist.
Twist. Oh, okay. That's how I use it. Okay. I have some other ones here. I think I know what I do with this. It's a clam. I know. I think I'm supposed to spin this, right?
Make sure the wood stays in place.
Oh, that's what I do with it. I put wood on it. Okay. Do I still spin this, though, right?
Do your best.
Okay, so I knew what to do. I just didn't know where to use it. This one's interesting.
Oh, paperweight. No? All right.
Any idea?
What is it?
It draws a chalk line.
Maggie was in the last service.
And I just got blue chalk all over me.
Just in case you're wondering.
And if there's any trustees here, none of it got on the carpet. Just on me. This one's real interesting, too. I think I know how to use this, right? It looks like I do this. But it doesn't... I don't know what to do. What would I use this on?
Is it scary?
Oh, someone read. It says wire stripper. So I have all of these tools here, and I think I knew how to use them, but I didn't know, or I knew what to do, but I didn't know how they were used.
They cut wires.
Awesome.
They help get out nails.
And they help get out nails.
Smart.
You know, as we're kind of learning about new tools, I'm kind of reminded that I'm reminded of the story that we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about a story in the book of Acts in which God asks people to go out and do something that they don't know exactly what they're going to do. He wants them to go to Jerusalem and to Samaria and to all the earths and be a witness. And they ask him, what's exactly going to happen? And Jesus goes out and says, you're not going to know exactly what, but you're going to be not alone. The Spirit's going to be with you, and people are going to help you. And that's the lesson that I kind of learned with the tools here, is I had people here that'll help me. And when I go out and do God's work, the Spirit will be with me too. Thank you all for teaching me. I had a wonderful time. And I'm excited that God's calling us to go do other things. So I'm going to have us pray together. Would you guys like to pray together? I love to pray with y'all. Dear Jesus. Thank you for loving us.
Thank you for loving us.
Sometimes God.
I don't know everything.
And
it
makes me a little scared.
Help me.
Know
that I can ask you
and people around
for help.
Send me
where you want me.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Yay, Jesus! Thank you guys so much for coming. We do have kids' church. If you don't want to hear me talk anymore, it's probably a lot more fun over there. But it's also a lot of fun in here, too.
Thank you, Sally Best, for giving us our ministry moment today about Vacation Bible Blast.
Oh, I'm so excited, friends, because we get to do Vacation Bible Blast in person. Can we get a hallelujah for that? Amen. It is so good to see all of y'all here today. I'm overwhelmed with joy. I could almost cry to see everybody here in person. And I want to let you know, so I'm Sally Best. We attend the first service. That's my family back there. There's a whole bunch of children back there. And we do a lot of fun things together throughout the year and travel and do all kinds of neat things, but one of our favorite weeks of the year, and I'm not kidding, is Vacation Bible School, and we couldn't be more thrilled that it's back and that you have the opportunity to get to serve too. I'm just here to remind you that that's available to you. So the 1st through the 4th of June, we have from 9 a.m. to 12 Vacation Bible Blast. Miss Stephanie has worked so hard to get us ready for it. There's children already signed up, ready to come. And I know you don't need to be reminded, but a lot of those kids that are coming, they do not have Jesus taught in their home. And this might be one of the only places that they get to hear about him. By the way, Handbricks, thank you for those songs this morning. God has gone before us, because those songs that y'all sang and said and believed tell us that we need to tell the story. And this is an opportunity to get to do that. The world is being brought to us here in our comfy, beautiful church, and you have the opportunity to do that. And there's lots of ways to do that. Now, I see some of you looking at me. I'm going to study you very closely. Okay? And I know a lot of you, I know what you're thinking. I'm no mind reader. I don't believe in that. But I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, Sally, I've done that. I've been there and done that. I've served in Sunday school and block party and breakout and youth and da-da-da. And you know what I think? Awesome! You are qualified to come help. Yes, you can do hard things for 4 days. For 4 hours. Yes, you can. God will provide you all the strength and energy and wisdom that you need to come and witness to these children. I promise you he will. He does it for me. There's no insomnia for VBS workers during the week of VBS, because you go home and you are so tired that you take the best naps and the best sleep of your life. Now, I know another thing that you're probably thinking. I'm really going to study you very closely now. Okay? You're thinking, but kids these days, they're harder than we were. And I want to tell you, as I've been studying you, I'm like, I see a few reformed Eddie Haskells and Dennis is the Menace and Ramona Geraldine Quimby's, okay? Somebody was there to guide you and mold you and shape you. And yeah, maybe kids might be worse today. I can't say. I don't know that for sure. God knows. But this is our opportunity to be there for them and to help them. And there will be, if we can, we can share the blessing, not a burden, the blessing of serving. If we have more hands and more feet, it is a lot easier for all of us. There's lots of jobs you can do. If you don't want the blessing of being in the classroom like I do, I will fight you for my opportunity to do crafts, because I've said in perpetuity, that is my job. You don't get to have that one, because I want to be in there with them, watching them learn and grow and create. I want to be hands-on with the kiddos. But if that's not your thing, that's okay. You can help with transportation or safety or decor or snacks. There's all kinds of things. Stephanie has a list outside already ready. So if you've been waiting to be asked, congratulations. This is your invitation to come serve our children. You all, listen, I talked about the kids that have Jesus in their homes, that don't have Jesus in their homes. I know four that have Jesus in their home, and they still need you. They still need you. Please come and help out and serve. There's a desk out there where you can sign up. You can talk to Stephanie. She's done a beautiful job preparing for that. And then if you cannot serve in person, there's another great opportunity. You can fast and pray every Saturday leading up to VBB. Now, I see a lot of you are excited about that. So just come serve with us in person, okay? And then you don't have to do the fasting and praying, although I know a lot of you love doing that. But anyway, thank you for letting me share that. I'm so passionate about it. Also, invite your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren. Bring them with you and then stay to help, okay? And then you can all go home and eat lunch and take a nap, okay? But invite them. I know you're ready to have them back into your homes. Thank you so much.
Real quick, Sally, I just want to say thank you. We are doing a big push. I know what you're thinking, though. Co-teacher, scared, classroom, teaching, leadership. I get it. Don't worry. Mark and our skit team is going to be teaching, so all you have to do is walk 10 kids at a time to snacks, crafts, games. Super easy. Co-teacher just means there's two of you just moving our little precious friends. They are signed up, Emily and Julia, so they're already going. So help us help them get to their rooms, their designated rooms. There's a place to sign up in the back. I want y'all to serve where you feel most equipped. I will never ask you to serve in an area that you do not want to serve in. If crafts is your gig, like Sally, do crafts. If games is your gig, hang with Alan. If you want to hang out with the precious kids, which is like one of my favorite things, around and just get to know them, build that rapport and that relationship. And you can always sign up to hang out with us on Sunday mornings at Kids Church and Sunday School. But we feel so honored that this is coming up, and we are super pumped. We've actually had a lot of you sign up. But we really do need co-teachers. It just means leadership moving around, moving our little friends here and there. But that's about it. And if y'all are coming to Kids Church, follow me. Let's do it.
Stephanie and Sally, thank you so much. I think y'all need to work on your enthusiasm. Friends, I'm so thankful for that kind of enthusiasm. And there's enthusiasm for a lot of ministries in our church, but this morning as our ministry moment, I want to give thanks for our children's ministry. And in the pews, you'll see there's some handmade cards, perhaps in your pew, perhaps not. If someone has one, hold it up. Okay, Jerry's got one over here. Those are designed by our block party children to give away to someone who needs encouragement. So if you know someone in your neighborhood or in your family or somebody who just needs a little encouragement, take that card and I bet you'll see a smile grace their face. What do you think? That's the kind of things with Vacation Bible School and Ministry Moment of Sunday School starting at 6 months in this church that always blows my mind. There's so many opportunities for children here, and so I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful not only for Stephanie and Sally, but for all of our children's volunteers. And when I'm thankful, I say, thanks be to God. This is the time when we make our offering, and since we don't pass the plates at this point, we may soon, but we don't right now. There are some boxes out in the foyer. There's a beautiful wooden box that Jack Ragsdale made for us that you can deposit your tithes and offerings. There's also a white box out there that you can tear off your communication card that I can't find. This one. You tear that off and drop it in that white box as you walk out the door today. And so please take note of those opportunities to be communicating with us and letting us know what your prayer concerns are. Again, we pray over those. And they're important to us, and so please be sure and share those with us. I'm thankful for so many things in this church, aren't you? There's always new things we can do. There's always new things we can learn and grow, but I'm thankful for those things. Let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for the ministry of the people in this room. For the ways they touch lives every day in their neighborhood, in their workplace, in their yards, in the grocery store. Everywhere they go, they smile. They silently pray for people that they see that are in distress or in need. Thank you, O God, for each of those persons. We thank you for each person who is here, but we thank you also for those who are worshiping online. We pray that every home represented here will be blessed. We know, Lord, that someday we go to heaven and we have a beautiful reward. If we believe in Jesus Christ, we'll be reunited with him in heaven. And what a beautiful thing that is. But we also know that here in this life, things are not always easy. So, Lord, whatever folks are going through this morning, I ask that you be with them right where they are. Maybe they're grieving like the Webb family, like the Gebhardt family. Maybe, oh God, they're struggling with illness like several that we've had in the hospital this week and at least one we know is having surgery this week. Maybe they struggle with loneliness. They're just so tired of being alone. I don't know, Lord, but I know that you do because you have that amazing ability to know exactly where we are. Help us, oh God, to turn to you, to lift our voices to you daily, multiple times a day, as we share the hard times we're going through, but as we also share the wonderful blessings, and we thank you for those. Thank you for the gift of prayer. Help us never take that for granted. Lord, I give thanks for the rain that we've received, and I pray humbly that we receive more, but not the drama. No hail, no tornadoes, just the wonderful life-giving shower like we had this morning to nourish our souls, to make our creeks run and our grass to perk, our trees to bloom out, thank you for that gift of rain. Oh God, I thank you for the graduates that I've seen on Facebook from Tarleton and Texas State and A&M and UT and all of the places in between, Baylor. Thank you for those wonderful celebrations of our youth, our young adults, not only in this church, but in our community. Perseverance to finish the task before them. And now, oh God, we pause and lift up other things that are on our hearts today. Oh God, for those things spoken silently or verbally, those things that remain in our hearts that wake us up at night, we lift them all before you and we trust them to you. And we thank you for being the God who hears us and meets our needs. Sometimes we see it, sometimes we don't. We pray for healing for all who are ill. We pray, oh God, for the chaos in the Middle East. And we pray, oh God, that your peace will prevail. Just cover those folks with your protection, oh God. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for not giving up on us. Thank you for sending your Son, our Savior, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
As we get ready, I always try to take what Jesus says seriously, and he says, pray for your enemies. So this whole week, I've been praying for oak pollen. I don't know if my spirit has changed with it. And I pray that my mixture of Benadryl and coffee gets me through this sermon. But on a more serious note, Sally did make a mention of an opportunity to pray and fast. And I really want us to take a moment and think. We'll be communicating via email this later in the week. But that is really an opportunity to help. And I do think organization of prayer and fast is as effective as being the hands and feet, hands-on as well. So pray, consider. I would like for many people to sign up for both of those opportunities in the coming week as the children come. With that, let me read here the scripture from the books of Acts, chapter 1, verse 6. So when they had come together, they asked him, this is Jesus, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom of Israel? He replied, It is not for you to know the time or the periods that your Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, and all of Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up towards heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up towards heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. This is the word of God for the people of God. As I was reading this text earlier in the week, I was thinking of one of my favorite memes. A meme, if you're not familiar with that vernacular, is something you experience often on the internet. It is a picture of something with some text below it, like a single comic strip. Many people often will click share with it. This particular meme, like many memes, may not be completely historically accurate, but it sometimes serves a purpose. This one was one by Henry Ford. And it says, if I would have asked the customer what they wanted, they would have said, a faster horse. That's a great saying. But Henry Ford didn't say it. It is interesting, though, I did a little finding, and the person who did say it was kind of the inventor of the modern-day cruise ship, the mega ship, if you would. And they asked him, how did you come up with the idea? Did you ask people what they wanted? And he said, well, no, you don't ask people what they want, if they would have asked Henry Ford. So it was a good quote from a champion of ministry, just not Henry Ford. Why I think of that is because if Jesus would have asked his disciples, what do you want to do to build the kingdom of God? You know what they would have said. Make it just like David's. Make it like when David was a king. That's what happens when they ask him, when will you establish the old kingdom? When will you make it just like it was before? And Jesus does what he often does, and not quite answer the question, but give a commission. When asked, when will it be just like before? He says, don't worry. I'm sending you the Holy Spirit and to go out to all of the places. Go out to your neighbors that are close by, people like you, people that share a same identity as you, but maybe are a little bit different. That's Samaria. And then go out to the ends of the earth. This happens in the beginning of the book of Acts, which is the tail end of the Gospel of Luke, part 2, if you would. And right after the story, they replace Judas, and then they have the story of Pentecost. It all happens quite quickly. And there's not a whole lot of detail given. I might even go as far as to say that Jesus is asking them to do something that they don't quite know, which is why the theme of this Sunday is springing into the unknown. I feel like oftentimes, this might just be me looking into a mirror, but the thing that prevents me from doing things is not knowing what's going to happen. I've noticed in my 10 or so years of ministry that the best way to get more people to sign up is to give them as much information as possible ahead of time. People like to know what they're getting into, how long it's going to take, and you can get people to go to the ends of the earth before you can get someone to show up to a place and walk around and pray as a group. It almost seems like we have such a comfort with what is known. Maybe that's why these disciples of Jesus were so interested in clinging to what was. They knew what that was like. They had trouble imagining what the new kingdom would be like. They want to remember the things of old. But that doesn't mean that people aren't prepared. There's a difference between not knowing and not being able to do what's being asked. Because Jesus' disciples were prepared. And sometimes, I know this is hard to imagine, but you're being prepared for something to do that you do not know what that is. If you've been around a lot, you know I like food metaphors and stories from my past, and I don't do too many pop culture references. But as I was thinking of that idea that God prepares us for stuff to do before we know what it is, I could not get this one image escaped from my head. And it is of a cinematic classic that is 37 years old today. It's one of my favorite movies of all time. You might be familiar with it. The Karate Kid. There's been a newer one for younger folks in the audience with Jaden Smith, and this image comes up as well, but I'm going to try to stick to the one with Daniel and Mr. Miyagi. The most memorable scene for me, and for many, is probably this moment in which Daniel approaches Mr. Miyagi in frustration, thinking that he hasn't been prepared for the moment that's going on, that he does not know how to do karate, and that all he's been doing are these doggone chores. All I've done, sir, is wax on, wax off, sand on, sand off, paint and paint. Mr. Miyagi, in the wisdom of those exercises, has a moment and says, do it like this. Strong. Wax on. Wax off. Does no one know this movie? Okay. And I think, or I really know and believe, that sometimes our concept of ministry is that same way. God has called us to go out and to be witnesses. And sometimes we might think what we're doing here on Sunday or Monday or Tuesday or Wednesday or whatever you do in the church might seem like it's not going to help you be a witness into the world. But I believe that when that moment comes where God has prepared a moment for you to be a witness, the songs that you've sung, the Bible studies that you've had, the moments of prayer that you have done will be just like that wax on, wax off moment. The spiritual muscle memory of doing the things of church will be utilized going out. You just don't know how they're going to be utilized yet. You are prepared. You just don't quite know. This scripture comes from the very first chapter of Acts. And if you do not know, our Bible is not written in chronological order. It's not even written in order of authors. The book of Luke is also written by the book of Acts, and we put the book of John in the middle of it, and there's a reason for that. But when you read the book of Acts, it's really helpful for me to think of it as part two of the gospel. It's often described as this is the story of the early church, and us as a church, we can use it as a model. And what I find extremely interesting is all of the great things that seem to happen really often in the book of Acts don't seem like they were very well coached in the Gospel of Luke. Like, I see all of these great stories of Jesus spending time with his disciples, teaching him about God, but I never see Jesus pull Peter aside and be like, this is how you give a good sermon, because there's this thing Pentecost is going to happen, and you're going to have to talk in front of 3,000 people, so let me teach you bullet points. Let me tell you what to do with your hands. Jesus doesn't say, you know, Philip, you're going to have this encounter with this cross-cultural Ethiopian eunuch, and I'm going to make sure you know exactly how to address that situation and what scriptures to use and how to explain it. No, that doesn't seem what happens. It seems like Jesus, like Mr. Miyagi, is giving them spiritual memories of preparation. I think when people are hesitant to go out into their Jerusalem and to be a witness, it's because we don't quite feel like we don't know what we need to do. I used to do cold calls for sales. You know, if you give me a number and a script, I don't mind calling anyone. But that's not quite how Jesus asks us to encounter and build his kingdom. If Henry Ford asked what people wanted, they probably would have said a faster horse. If Mr. Miyagi asked Daniel what he wanted, he probably would have said, teach me how to karate chop. I think if Jesus would have asked his disciples, what do you want for the kingdom? They would have said, make it just like that image in Zechariah chapter 8, verse 22, or just like that image in Isaiah chapter 6, verse 30, where the kingdom is great and all of the nations are coming to us. Sometimes that image is true. As we've said a couple times this Sunday, Vacation Bible School is a moment where people will come to us. But I think Jesus here reminds them of the default function of the church, which is equipping and sending out into the world. Because I think if we would ask a lot of people, is, well, we'll have them come to church and Preacher Clay will talk to them. But maybe the Holy Spirit's asking you to go. You know, the people called Methodists, the history of which we find ourselves rooted in, were at one time very good at this. We went west as America went west. And we showed up places before there was buildings. They preached in fields. All they needed was a pulpit. I think maybe it's time that we remember our history found in the book of Acts. To go into Jerusalem, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. Maybe we call on our history of people called Methodists and go out into our neighborhoods. My final exercise for us here in the pulpit is perhaps to think about who might be or where might be your Jerusalem, your Samaria, and your end of the earth. I trust this conversation to happen with you and the Holy Spirit, but I have a little lesson metaphor that might be useful. I like to think of my Jerusalem as my neighborhood, and my neighborhood is probably not your neighborhood. It might be. We draw from people all over the Highland Lakes. And if you're wondering where your neighborhood is, I always like to think about gas stations. Like, where is your favorite gas station that you fill up 80% of the time? That's probably your neighborhood. And maybe your Jerusalem is all the people that use that same gas station. And where is your Samaria? Well, we know from other parts of Scripture that many people would choose to avoid traveling through Samaria and go a really long ways. So if there's a gas station or a certain part of the Highland Lakes community where you don't like to fill up gas, that's your Samaria. And, of course, the ends of the earth. That's Austin, right? I'm just going to say it's Austin. Maybe it's California. Who knows? But I do want to say this. I do know that what we do here on Sunday has prepared you. If you have sung songs, if you have prayed, if you have listened to preachers preach, observed children's sermons, if you have gone to Bible study, Emmaus reunion groups, you are waxed on and you have waxed off. God has prepared you to go do this work. You just may be like Daniel and not know how it's going to be used. Because there's a lot of unknown in this community. There's people that we do not know that God knows. And there's people who do not know about God's love. And we get the blessing of making that connection. We get to know people that God knows that we don't, and we get to tell them about God that they don't know about. God has called us to be that matchmaker and that kingdom builder in your Jerusalem and in your Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And I am prepared, and I am excited, and I can't wait to utilize all of this wax muscle I've built up. And for the opportunity and when it occurs, and when God lets me use all of this preparation that I have had, I am thankful. And when I'm thankful, I like to say, Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. We're getting ready to have a moment of discipleship. And there's a couple things that might occur in this moment. You might feel that God wants you to pray alone at the altar. You can come forward. If you keep your hands close, I will, and the pastors will make an assumption that you are trying to pray alone with God. If you reach your hands forward over the altar rail, we will make the assumption that you would like us to pray with you. You might also make a declaration that I want to be a part of this community. I want this to be my church home as we go help people know who God is. Or maybe, perhaps, you don't quite know who God is, and it might be a moment to discuss and talk about that as well. But everyone here gets an opportunity to sing about how they like to tell a story. Let us all stand and sing one of our favorite hymns, Blessed Assurance. Benediction is real simple. Go sing that song outside. God wants you to. God needs us to. In Jesus' name, amen.
This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior.